Hi everyone, welcome to Swissquote's daily market talk. US stocks are at record levels as the Fed starts its two-day meeting today. Bitcoin, energy and technology stocks are doing just fine as gold dives. So the week kicked off with major US indices renewing record on the back of a positive run in technology stocks on broad conviction that the low interest rates and the cheap liquidity are here to stay despite improved recovery prospects, jobs figures and the overshooting inflation. Investors trust Jay Powell more than they trust their own father, apparently, in that he won't remove the liquidity rug from under their feet. And how beautiful is that really? Now, Nasdaq advanced to a fresh all-time high as S&P 500 did, with investors turning a blind eye on their inflation recommendations, and they weren't wrong. So it paid off, because in the actual low interest rate environment, the rising inflation only pressures the real interest rates deeper in the negative territory. So this is a situation that should not last long, in my opinion, especially in an economic recovery cycle, but it will remain sweet and supportive as long as it lasts for stocks that love low interest rates, and that's the technology stocks. Apple hit by $130 per share. Short-term bullish call on reports of a faster Apple Watch with health features as temperature and blood sugar sensors. Investors just love that. News of a lawsuit claiming Apple intentionally degrades the performance and battery life of iPhones remains pretty much under the shadow of these new products and new features. And let's be honest with each other, the news of degrading battery got none of us by surprise, did it? So price-wise, as I said, we hit my initial short-term bullish call of $130 per share, and I expect to see some resistance near the $132 per share. A push above that level should pave the way for a further advance toward the $140 area, as Apple remains investors' darling, and we actually see the big old favorites such as Apple, Amazon and Facebook making a better start to this week, as favorite meme stocks see little interest, or at least they saw little interest on Monday, except for AMC, which jumped 15% again yesterday. So short sellers beware, Redditors are not letting the AMC go just for now. Now elsewhere, Katie Wood's ARK Innovation ETF, which is made of nearly 10% Tesla, 6% Teladoc Health, Roku, Square, Zoom, some 3.5% Coinbase, Twilio, Shopify, Spotify, is doing much better for those willing to return to a mixed tech portfolio to benefit from the actual risk-supportive low-rate environment. And besides Zoom, I don't necessarily see any of these stocks getting hammered by the post-pandemic life, really. Now, let's talk about that post-pandemic life, new lifestyle. Goldman Sachs is bringing its employees back to the office. So the next big thing will be which companies keep the work from home set up, which would want all their employees back in the office, and which would opt for a mix of work from home and work from office, and how these choices, these company choices, would affect their competitive advantage. So news like this, return to the office, are obviously inflation friendly. That means more travel, more activity, more life. All good for inflation stocks, obviously, but maybe not for all of them, apparently. Banks, for example, which are one of the major pillars of this reflation trade, may not do as well as market projected initially. JP Morgan warned a 38% decline in second quarter trading revenue, for example. That is larger than expected fall as market volatility fades away despite the meme and crypto craziness. And of course, the low interest rate environment doesn't really help boosting the interest revenue of the banks just yet, and interest rates will likely remain where they are at the extreme low levels for some more time. So, okay, let's talk about that. Right. So the Fed begins its two-day meeting amid fresh records on equity markets, quite strong jobs figures in the US, and inflation at 5%. Nonetheless, I won't make this long. There should be no change in FOMC's ultra-supportive monetary policy stance this week. The only hawkish risk here is a taper talk, or a talk on when to start the taper talk, in my opinion. But the chances are we won't hear anything crispier than the Fed officials not opening that that topic at all before September. So that's my expectation. And the tapering itself will probably not start before next year, as cutting bond purchases is just an appetizer in a full course menu, obviously, and no one's willing to move on to the main course, the main deal, which is rate normalization just yet, and never really. There's one thing though, it looks like not everybody is equally comfortable with these fast rising inflation numbers. In that, New York Fed, for example, revised its one-year inflation expectation to 4% in May from 3.1% a month earlier. So that's a good upside revision, to be honest with you. The US 10-year yield remains comfortably near the 150% on the other hand, and the gap between the US inflation and the 10-year yield is at the highest since 1980. So let's see how investors would tolerate and react to a probably indifferent Fed facing this inflation. But to me, this strategy is like keeping a lion in a cage. These rates should be much higher, at least significantly higher, because trust is great, but blind trust obviously increases the risks of seeing a delay in softening inflation and not reacting to that, and a quick readjustment in the US yields, which would shatter stock markets, could happen in the aftermath of so much trust. So despite the US big caps flirting with record highs, red flags are there, and one of them is the persistent rise in oil prices. A barrel of US crude pushes higher above the $70 per mark on the back of a sweet blend of improved economic activity and travel prospects, of stronger global demand, a strict OPEC supply, and a fast declining global glut as a result of higher global demand and subdued global supply. So the risk that Iran could shortly see its sanctions lifted and add some 46 million barrels per day into the mix doesn't really seem to be a major concern for oil bulls just yet, as additional oil supply could easily be absorbed by the rising demand nowadays. But there is one thing that could dent the oil rally, and that's inflation. The rapid rise in oil and commodity prices fans the inflationary pressures worldwide, and if we don't see stabilizing in raw material prices shortly, the Fed's transitory inflation theory would fall in ruins, and that could actually force the Fed to tighten its financial conditions earlier than thought. And if that's the case, well, the recovery prospects would ease and it could weigh on oil prices in return. So in conclusion, oil's upside potential will likely remain capped by its own success, and I believe we won't see the barrel trading above the $75-$78 area without inviting the bears to the table. But energy stocks are obviously surfing on firmer oil prices nowadays, and one of my top oil stock picks, which is BP, is now trading at year high of 330p right now. We could see further gains in the short run, in my opinion, toward the 350p region before a downside correction in oil prices kick in and pressures BP lower along with it. But I keep my 12-month price target at 450p for BP. Now, gold, on the other hand, is set for extending losses toward the 200-day moving average, which is near $1840 level. I revised my bearish call on gold from 1875, 1850 to 1830, 1840 region this week, if the combination of subdued yields and high inflation couldn't bring gold bulls to the party, then there is obviously more interest in riskier and better rewarding assets nowadays. And interestingly, we again see an interesting negative correlation between gold and Bitcoin. Now, gold's recent surge towards $1,900 area had coincided with Bitcoin's sell-off, and Bitcoin recovery seems to pressure gold prices lower nowadays. It doesn't mean Bitcoin is alternative to gold, but it's probably the contrary. Bitcoin is more correlated with risk assets, and improved risk appetite, which sends safe haven gold lower, has a supportive effect on Bitcoin. And of course, we know that Bitcoin's recent surge has been triggered by an Elon Musk tweet, which said Tesla would resume its transactions in Bitcoin if Bitcoin mining becomes sufficiently green. So Elon Musk doesn't have the same influence on other assets, happily, so not on gold, not even on Tesla. And Bitcoin is now testing the $40,000 offers on that tweet, but the major resistance to be taking out is the 200-day moving average near negative 42,500 level. And to be honest with you, maybe the negative correlation with gold is just a coincidence. Now, this is all for today. I'm Ipek Ozkardeskaya, and thank you for joining me. I hope this episode of Market Talk has been helpful and insightful to you. Please do not hesitate to leave your comments, your reactions, and your questions below, and follow us on Twitter and on LinkedIn for regular market updates, and subscribe to our YouTube channel for daily market comments. I meet you again tomorrow, and until then, good day trading.